Today's topic is what polyps of large intestine. I have already told you what is a polyp. Anyway, I'll tell you the definition. Any mass or tumor which projects in the lumen, which arises from the mucosa of the intestine and projects in the lumen, that is called polyp. So if any tumor or cancer which projects in the lumen of the GIT, it is called polyp. Now, what is the importance of polyp? There are two types of polyp, that is neoplastic and non-neoplastic. Non-neoplastic are not important, but neoplastic polyps, which are called adenoma, they are important. Why they are important? Because they are precursors of carcinoma, and most carcinoma of the colon arise in the these neoplastic polyp. So there are different types of neoplastic polyp and there are different types of non-neoplastic polyp. We will be discussing that. Now, that is a classification, and then if you see the morphology of tubular and villous, and now these are two types of this neoplastic polyp. And why in comparison they are asking? Because one is more malignant transfer. This villous is more dangerous than the tubular, and that's why you should know what is the difference between the morphology of the two. So that is the importance of this lecture. In addition to that, there are certain hereditary familial conditions where not one or two, the hundreds and thousands of polyps are there in GIT, and they are precancerous. So we will be talking at the end of the lecture briefly about some of those conditions, which are called familial polyposis syndrome. Now, this is a mucosa of the colon, a large intestine and rectum. You can see there is no villi. Intestine has got villi. This has got no villi. And these are all the mucosal cells. They are absorptive cells as well as secretory cells. Secretory cells produce this mucus forming cells. These are the goblet cells. These are vacuoles. These are the goblet cells, and others are absorptive cells. So you should know the structure of histology of colon mucosa and large intestine mucosa. Now, what is the definition of polyp? It is a small elevation or protruding mass above the surface of bowel mucosa. So any elevation or mass which is above the surface of bowel mucosa, it is called polyp. Now these are the polyps. You see, this is mucosa, and these two, three polyps are there, which are on the surface of the mucosa. They are attached to mucosa, means they arise from the mucus layer. And there are two types, one sessile, means they don't have stalk. And pedunculated means they have got a stalk attached. So means they have got long stalk. They are sessile, has got no stalk, means they are attached to mucosa without any stem. This has got a stem. And they are all detected by endoscopy. Now this is the classification of polyps of colon. Histological classification, non-neoplastic and neoplastic. Neoplastic is called adenoma. The polyp type of non-neoplastic is hyperplastic, juvenile and inflammatory, and they have got little or no malignant potential. So that's why differentiation of non-neoplastic and neoplastic is important. Now this juvenile polyp is hematoma, hematomatous. I have already told you what is hematoma, what is teratoma and all that. These are local malformation of the tissue, and they form a tumor-like mass. So this juvenile is hematomatous. And inflammatory polyp is pseudopolyp because it is a collection of inflammatory cells or granulation tissue. So these are the three types of non-neoplastic polyp: hyperplastic, juvenile, inflammatory. Now, neoplastic, that is adenoma, a real tumor. So there is tubular adenoma. They have got villi, you know, the finger-like projection. They don't have a villous projection. They have got tubules only. They have got 0 to 25% of villous tissue. Now this villous adenoma has got 75 to 100% of villous tissue. Villi are there in 75 to 100% of the tumor or adenoma. Here less than 25%. And in between is the tubulovillous adenoma, in which the both are there, 25 to 75% villous tissue. So less than 25%, more than 75% and in between that is 25 to 75%. So depending on the amount of villous tissue, these three types of adenoma are there: tubular, tubular villus, and villus adenoma. And why these villi are important? They are the most malignant part. These villus adenoma, which is the maximum villi, they are have got potential to become malignant in large number of people. Now coming to the non-neoplastic polyp, first one is hyperplastic polyp. This size is 90% in large intestine and most common in the rectum. Age is above 60 years. It is caused by epithelial hyperplasia and delayed shedding of the surface epithelium. This leads to piling up of goblet cells and absorptive cells. So it is a epithelial hyperplasia means that the apoptosis delayed. So there is a delayed shedding of the epithelial cell and epithelial hyperplasia. You know, epithelium of GIT is always dividing. No, so that's why epithelial hyperplasia, delayed shedding leads to the piling up of this epithelial cell, that is goblet cell and absorptive cell, and that forms a small polyp. These polyps are very small; they are less than 5 millimeter. You can see nipple-like protrusion of the mucosa. They are single or multiple, and under microscope they have got serrated crypts lined by goblet cell, absorptive cell. And separate, these glands are, these crypts are separated by very scant stroma. So these are the normal mucous epithelium which has hyperplasia, and there is a lack of shedding, so that's why there is collection of these and forming hyperplastic polyp. So under microscope they are serrated crypts, means they have got tooth like from the sides. And they are lined by goblets and absorptive cells. So that is hyperplastic polyp, and it is very small. That is less than 5 millimeter. You can see less than 0.5 centimeter. Now this is hyperplastic polyp. This one, see this small one, nipple-like projection on the mucosa. And if you compare with adenomatous, those adenoma neoplastic polyp, they are big. They are quite big. So this is just to show the. Now these are the serrated these crypts. These are the crypts lined by goblet cells. This is the transverse section. This is serration showing this. And these are the under microscope serrated crypts of intestinal epithelium. So this is a hyperplastic polyp. Now second is juvenile polyp or hematomatous polyp. It is hematoma, that is focal malformation of mucosal epithelium and lamina propria. Means they are jumbled up in a fashion to form a tumor-like mass. So that is called hematoma. Normal structure of a tissue organ which is jumbled up like in lung or here in the mucosa. Lamina propria, that is the connective tissue part and epithelial part, they jumble up and form a mass like tumor. So it is called hematoma. So this juvenile polyp is hematomatous polyp. And less than 5 years of age, it occurs in children. And it occurs less than 5 years of age, and it is called retention polyp. Why it is called retention polyp? Because the secretion of the glands are not coming out of the glands in the lumen because they are malformation. You know, they are not connected. They are jumbled up. Stroma as well as the glands are jumbled up together. So the secretion accumulates in the glands and it forms cyst-like spaces. So that is the, and it occurs in children less than 5 years and most commonly in rectum. They are also called retention polyp because retention means they retain the mucosities. Gross, they are larger than hyperplasia, 1 to 3 centimeter in diameter, and they have got smooth surface. Single, they are occur in single, that is one. And they have got stalk. They have got a stalk. Stalk means stem. Sometimes 2 centimeter long. So this has got a stalk. This is a pedunculated polyp. As I told you, pedunculated means stalk. Now under microscope, cut surface shows those cystically dilated glands lined by, filled with mucus, and stroma is infiltrated by chronic inflammatory cells. So it is a, under microscope you will see dilated glands containing mucus and surrounded by chronic inflammatory cells. And that is a juvenile polyp. So this is a cut section of joint. These are the cysts. These are under high power. You see, these are the cystic spaces containing mucus. And this is stalk. This is mucosa. This is stalk. So this is juvenile polyp. Now this is, see that here those spaces are bigger. Now inflammatory polyp are also called pseudo polyp. Pseudo polyp because they are not real polyp. They are irregular shaped islands of residual intact colonic mucosa. Generally, they are seen in inflammatory bowel disease. There is a lecture on inflammatory bowel, that is ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease. So in those conditions, these are found because between the ulcer, the whatever epithelium is there, that proliferates and forms a finger-like projection. So those are the inflammatory pseudo polyp. So result of mucosal ulceration and regeneration that occurs in inflammatory bowel disease. So they are seen in the IBD, that is ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease. And they are irregular shaped islands of residual intact colonic mucosa that result from the mucosal ulceration. Those mucosa which are left between the ulcers, there are multiple ulcers. So those are formed islands and they are called inflammatory polyp. And they are also called pseudopolyp. And typically they are multiple, often filiform is finger-like projection. And they are scattered throughout the colon. See the severe ulcerative coli. These are all small nodes under the endoscope. Now this is these are granulation tissue. See the blood vessel, chronic inflammatory cell, macrophage. And these are those, and there is ulcer on the top. You see? And these are the glands which are deformed in the intestine. So this is the pseudopolyp. It has got ulcerated surface. And lined with granulation tissue. So this polyp has got ulcer there. These are granulation tissue. And the underlined crypts, these are the crypts. They are distorted and contain regenerative epithelium. And there are increased number of plasma cell and lymphocyte in the lamina propria. So that is a non-neoplastic polyp, that is inflammatory polyp, hematomatous or juvenile polyp, and hyperplastic polyp. And we come to the neoplastic polyp. Now these are precancerous. They are also called adenomatous polyp. They are called adenoma. And they are precancerous, means high incidence of cancer in them. And they are intraepithelium. They are real neoplasia. That's why they are called adenoma. Small to large, they may be having a stem that is sessile. They may not have any stem that is sessile, or they may be having a stalk which is a pedunculated. Now, as I told you, there are three types: tubular adenoma, most common, found all over the GIT, either in stomach, duodenum, small intestine, jejunum, and colon. And they are pedunculated. They have got a stalk, stem, or they can be sessile. Both can be there. And they have got low cancer risk. As I told you, more tubules means only less than 25% of villi are there. Most of them are tubules. Then there is a villus adenoma, this last one, often large, and this is not pedunculate. It is sessile. It is attached to mucosa and it is large. It has very high cancer risk. Its incidence is 1% and this high cancer risk. And tubular villus adenoma is intermediate cancer risk between the tubular adenoma and villus adenoma, and they have got mixture of tubular glands as well as villi, that is 25 to 75%. So this is how you differentiate between all three. And why it is differentiated? Because they have got increasing incidence of cancer. At the villus adenoma has got high cancer risk and tubular adenoma has less, and in between is tubular villus adenoma. Now what is a tubular adenoma? Tubular adenoma are the most common of the types and can be found anywhere in GIT, as already told you. 50% are found in rectum and sigmoid colon. They are pedunculated. Large one have a stalk, 1 to 2 cm long stem they have got. And surface is raspberry-like pink. And under microscope, the head, that is not stalk, that is head of the adenoma, composed of network of branching tubular and round glands. And to be classified as tubular adenoma, the adenoma should have a tubular component of 75% or more. So this is a tubular adenoma, means tubular glands will be there, which will be forming more than 75% of the gland tumor. So this is tubular adenoma, and this is a gross picture. This is stalk, this is the adenoma. See the big stalk here, and this is adenoma, this is mucosa, and these are the tubular glands. See, mostly they know villi in this. Then Villus adenoma account for 5 to 15% of 15% of adenoma. Site is rectum and sigmoid colon. Occurs in old age, and it is very large. It can be 10 cm large. Or spread on the mucosa of the this colon and rectum, and it doesn't have a stalk, or it is not pedunculated. So it is grossly, it is a sessile. Sessile means no stalk. Cauliflower like, that I told you, all the tumors cauliflower appearance, they project in the that is called nodular surface. So they are forming cauliflower like mass, project 1 to 3 cm above the normal mucosa. So this is Villus adenoma. See this, these are all Villus adenoma on the surface, large area. These are individual villi which were seen under the endoscopy. Now under microscope, they are characterized by glands that are long and extend straight down from the surface to the center of the polyp. And is epithelium shows dysplastic. Dysplastic changes means hyperchromasia. Hyperchromasia, pleomorphism, all those features of malignancy. So these dysplastic changes are seen in these glands. And to be classified as villus, I told you, they must have villus component more than 75%. And in 45% of them, a carcinoma is found when biopsy is done in this villus adenoma. That's why I tell you, this is a very high risk of cancer, this villus adenoma. That's why important, and that's why it is important to differentiate between the three. So that is a villus adenoma. Gross picture. See, these are the hyperchromatic epithelial cells. These are villi. You see, these are villi, finger-like projections, because these are villus. So this is cut like this, and these epithelial cells are showing dysplastic changes. This is a long serrated. This is the deep pits coming up to here. These are all villi. So that's why it is called villus adenoma. And hardly there are any tubular glands. Now, there is a mixture of both, that is tubular villus. So tubular villus is mixture of both villi as well as tubules, 75% will be the tubular component, and they are sessile, covered by slender villi, have 26 to 75% villus component. The degree of villus component of these adenoma is correlated with the risk of progression to cancer. This is tubular villus. Villus adenoma. Still people are coming. These are the tubular villus. They are all sessile. And this is a microscope. You see, these are tubular glands. These. And these are villi. So it is mixture of tubular glands as well as villi. So this is a calci. This is tubular gland. This is another one. So this is the three types of adenoma. And what is difference between adenoma, tubular as well as villus? See, this can be asked because this is your syllabus. Site, tubular adenoma can occur any part of GIT, from stomach to small intestine, large intestine. Villus adenoma occurs only in colon and rectum. Pedunculated mainly. Tubular is mainly pedunculated. It has got a stalk. Villus is always sessile, which it has got no stalk. Surface of the tubular is smooth. Villus surface is villiform, that is finger-like projection. Glands are tubular. In villus, their glands are deep and straight glands going up to center of the polyp. No dysplasia and epithelium in tubular. Dysplastic epithelium in the villus. Cancer risk is less in tubular, and cancer risk is high. So this this differentiation you must remember. And in tubular gland, tubular adenoma, tubular component is 75% or more. In villous adenoma, villous component is 75%. And tubulovillar 25 to 75% is the tubular end. So these are the three types of adenoma, which are very important, tubular, villous, and tubulovillar. And now we have finished the polyps of the large intestine, that is neoplastic, non-neoplastic, hyperplastic, juvenile, and pseudopolyp, that is inflammatory polyp. And neoplastic polyp includes the tubular adenoma, tubulovillous adenoma, and villous adenoma. I have talked about their gross appearance, their morphology, their incidence, their risk factor for the carcinoma. Now we go to familial polyposis syndrome. Now this is, I don't know if it is there in your syllabus or not, but you should know about it, because this is also a very precancerous condition. They are uncommon. They are uncommon. They are autosomal dominant disorders, so they run in the families. Their importance lies in propensity of malignant transformation. See, these are the three things: autosomal dominant, their pre-malignant condition, and their familial syndrome. And these are the various types of polyposis syndrome. Familial polyposis, that is FAP, Peutz-Jeghers syndrome, familial juvenile polyposis, Gardner syndrome, Turcot syndrome, Cowdenbey. And some of these syndromes have got extra intestinal features. We'll be talking about it. Now coming to the one which is a important, familial adenopterous polyposis. This is a FAP and genetic defect in APC gene. APC gene on chromosome 5q21, and there are 500 to 2005 colonic adenoma. So there are 500 to 2500 adenomas in the colon, and they are like a carpet on the mucosal surface. Minimal number 100 is required for the diagnosis of FAP, familial adenopterous adenomatous polyposis. They are also present elsewhere in the hepatic tract, including almost 100% in the duodenal duodenum, that is causing duodenal adenoma. And most polyps are tubular adenoma, means they have got most, that is 75% will be tubules, gland will be like a tubules, not a villi. Polyps usually become evident in adolescent or early adulthood, and the risk of colonic cancer is 100% by midlife, unless prophylactic colectomy is performed. So what is treatment of this? They always do before it turns into cancer, they remove the colon. So this is a FAP. So that was familial adenomatous polyposis syndrome. See, this is a colon removed in FAP. See the number of polyps. Can you count it? It is more than 1,000. Now second familial syndrome is Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. It is again autosomal dominant. It is characterized by gastrointestinal polyposis with mucocutaneous pigmentation. There is a black pigmentation around the mouth. See, this is the mucocutaneous pigmentation in Peutz-Jeghers children. Now there are polyposis in the GIT and mucocutaneous pigmentation. That is Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. You should remember that this is autosomal dominant. And here the polyps are not adenoma, they are hematomatous. And they are most prevalent in small jejunum, ileum, and duodenum, but can occur elsewhere in GIT. And this syndrome is caused by germline mutation in the LKB gene. And in individual Peutz-Jeghers syndrome are at the increased risk of intestinal and extra intestinal malignancy. So this is a Peutz-Jeghers syndrome, multiple gastrointestinal polyps with mucocutaneous pigmentation. These polyps are hematomatous, and they can occur all over the intestine. The most common is small intestine. LKB gene is mutated, and it is associated with intestinal as well as extra intestinal malignancy. Now see, this is a mucocutaneous pigmentation in a Peutz-Jeghers syndrome, and under microscope the polyp is hematomatous, glandular epithelium supported by smooth muscle cells that is contiguous to muscular mucosa. So it is a mixture of muscular mucosa, that is a muscle layer, as well as glandular epithelium, and they jumbled up and form polyp-like mass. So that is a hematomatous polyp. And in the Peutz-Jeghers syndrome, if you see this, this is a under microscope. These are the all glands, and in between you will find the smooth muscle, and there is smooth muscle coming up to his surface. That is a diagnostic feature. Generally, smooth muscle should be here, down. See, and low, high power. These are the muscular layer going in the this, because these are found in more in the small intestine. You can see these will like, these are polyps. So that was a Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. Now we come to familial juvenile polyposis. So it is autosomal dominant. There were 300 to 200 hematomatous. These are also hematomatous polyps. They are more in the colon rectal region, colon and rectum. And a small minority may have in stomach, a small intestine. They are associated pulmonary arteriovenous malformation. As I told you, they have got all these familial polyposis. Some of them have got extra intestinal manifestation. And this familial juvenile polyposis associated increased risk of development of colorectal cancer. And in some families, gastric cancer. So see, it is like that juvenile polyp that was again hematomatous polyp. See, all the cystic glands, because secretion is retained and there is no communication of the glands outside. So this is a hematomatous polyp. So familial juvenile polyposis syndrome. And then these are other Gardner syndrome, Charcot syndrome, Cowden syndrome. These are different other associated colony gardnermatous polyposis. Osteoma is there, soft tissue tumor, deep dermoid cyst, fibroma, desmoid tumor. They are all associated with that. Then Charcot syndrome includes endometrious polyp, medulloblastoma, congenital hypertrophy. Cowden syndrome is caused by the mutation of the P10 gene, and it is associated with hematomatous polyp, fibrocystic disease, breast cancer. So these are the different type of, this is a mandibular osteoma associated with this, that Gardner syndrome, demonstrating mandibular osteoma in that. That is an extra intestinal manifestation. And there is no cancer risk. The second one is juvenile polyp, which is a hematomatous, means there is a jumble of mass of muscles, and that is lamina propria as well as mucosa. And that forms a juvenile polyp. So the glands, the lumen doesn't open on the surface of mucosa, so they are secretions are retained, that's why they are called retention polyp, and they are present in the rectum, and they occur in children less than 5 years of age, and they may be pedunculated, and on gross section you will find the cyst on the surface of the cut surface of the polyp, and under microscope you will find the dilated glands, cyst-like glands. There is no cancer risk in that. Generally, they are removed, and children come with bleeding per rectum. They are generally single. And then, of course, that inflammatory polyp or pseudo polyp that occurs in inflammatory bowel disease, that is ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease. And those are the residual mucosa which proliferate. And these mucosa, residual mucosa, in between the ulcers. That's snake-like ulcer in between those mucosa which is intact, that forms the polyp-like thing, and they are quite a large number of polyps, finger-like projections. So that is an inflammatory polyp or pseudopolyp. Then coming to second group, that is neoplastic polyp. Those are three groups: tubular adenoma, tubulovillous adenoma, and villous adenoma. Now this classification is based on amount of villi and tubules in the adenoma, percentage of villous component as well as tubular component, and that also is associated with risk factor for the malignancy. So the more tubular component, less risk of malignancy; more villous component, high risk of malignancy. So tubular adenoma, which has got less than 25% villous, most than 75% more are tubular glands, has got a less risk of cancer, and they can be one or multiple, and they can be found in other part of the intestine also. And under the grossly they are 3 to 5 centimeter, and they may be pedunculated, and under microscope they have got tubular glands mainly. Then villous adenoma is other extreme, where more than 75% component is the villous adenoma, that is finger like projection. They are predominantly non pedunculate, they don't have a stalk, and under the there can be very large, up to 10 cm carpet like on the surface of the mucosa. They form they are attached to surface of mucosa flat, and under microscope those spits of the gland, they are very deep going base of the tumor, and they are lined by dysplastic epithelium. That's why there is a very long there is high risk of malignant transformation. So that is a villous adenoma, and in between the two is a tubulovillous, that is a 25 to 75% of will be there component will be mixture of the both tubular and villous. Now that has got intermediate risk of carcinoma. So these are the different types of polyps of the intestine. So that is in our syllabus, and you should know also what is difference between tubular adenoma and villous adenoma. As I told you, site, that one occurs in the colon or rectum. Tubular can be anywhere. Then there is low risk, a high risk, and gross microscopic features, and then risk of cancer, what is site, number, they are single, they are maybe multiple. So all this you should know. Mainly the differentiation is with for the risk of cancer. Now there are certain familial cancer syndrome also, familial polyposis syndrome they are called, then adenomatous polyposis syndrome, that is FAP is because of APC mutation, and there are multiple polyps in the small intestine and also large intestine. They may be 2,000, 5,500, but 100 number of polyps required to diagnose FAP. They also have got an increased risk of cancer. They are autosomal dominant, and they occur in the family. And then second one, Peutz Jeghers, which is associated with multiple polyps of the small intestine and mucocutaneous pigmentation, and they are all hematomatous polyp, as I told you, the jumble of mass of muscular tissue and glandular tissue, and they also have got a risk of high risk of cancer. And then there is juvenile polyposis syndrome, familial juvenile polyposis, there that again hematomatous polyp, juvenile polyp, that cystic dilated gland will be there. So those Peutz Jeghers as well as familial juvenile polyposis, both are hematomatous, but there is a difference between the two, because in familial adenomatous polyposis, familial juvenile polyposis, there is a cystic dilatation of the glands because their lumen is not opening on the surface, whereas in the Peutz Jeghers there is a mixture of muscle and the gland proliferation. They know dilatation of the cystic dilatation of the gland, and they know retention. So this is not retention cyst, those are the retention, that juvenile. And then last one of course is those Gardner Turcot and other syndrome which are, so you should remember there is familial polyposis syndrome, and most important you should know familial adenomatous polyposis, Peutz Jeghers. Peutz Jeghers people may ask, or it may be in the MCQ. And third one, juvenile polyposis. So that is all about the polyps of the GI, this colon and rectum.